What's poppin', man? It's your kid Rosewood Bait. Rosewood shit. And I'm tuned in, locked in right now at Do It But Don't. Tap in, man. You heard?
Ooh, you got me tripping, got me sipping. Did 150 in the Jeep. I got your number, but I want you sitting right here next to me. Do what you do for me, baby. That's cool with me. Girl, it's just you and me. Come on and cruise with me, yeah. And why you gotta be like that?
What's good, Do It But Don't? Purple World, episode 44. I always, even though I look right before, almost forget the number. But today, double digits. I don't know why I said double digits. It's been double digits, but fake angel numbers. Fake angel numbers. We got a special guest. Been requested for almost a year, like I was just telling him. But Mr. Rosewood Bape, what's going on?
What's up, man? Rosewood shit. Be somebody. Somebody. What's popping, man? Do what's it but don't, man. On? What it is, bro?
What's good, yo? What you been up to?
Man, just, you know what I mean, planting seeds, bro, planting seeds, Jersey, New York, you know what I mean, just getting ready for that RFN, that's that Rose From Nothing coming out this year, man. Rose From Nothing, that's a new album.
You're dropping a project this year?
Dropping a project this year, man, you feel me?
You put that out already?
Nah,
people
nah,
know
nah,
that? Oh,
nah,
so
nah,
this nah. is just being
told, yeah, yeah,
right?
Yeah.
Let's go.
You know, I had to come check you to just to, you know what I'm saying, let people know something.
Let's go. So yeah. what can people, normally, before we get into that, just give them like a little rundown on just who you are, what you do, for those who don't know.
Hey, man, already. You know, shit, I'm Rosewood Bape, hit maker, you know what I mean? Shit, songwriter, artist, you know what I mean? Visionaire, all of the above, man. Dot connector, you feel me? So, you know, that's just what it is I do, man. But my passion is really in just the music, you know what I mean? You know, recording, writing, and just making hits, man, you feel me? I'm big into the arts, you feel me?
So how'd you get into music in the first place?
Man, dog, shit, I answer this question in a minute.
Move the mic a little closer.
Yeah.
A little tiny bit.
I would say that in 2009, 2010, I had bought my first little karaoke mic.
God damn.
In like Walgreens or some shit like that. And I had downloaded this program called Mixcraft. And then
Mixcraft, what's that?
It's like the Pro Tools before Pro Tools. Like what? It's like a kindergarten version of Pro Tools, you know what I mean? What? Very easy to maneuver. You feel me? So I had bought that and just started recording myself, man. Just started singing on the mic. You feel me? And I, you know, I love to sing. I love R&B. So, you know, I just started to just experiment with my sound and see what I can come up with and try to be different, stand out. So that was like, I've been doing music for a minute. So, and I never told no one this story though. My grandma, rest in peace, she was big into music at her church. You feel me? So she used to bring a cam, a voice recorder. This is like 90s, man. A little record thing, you know what I mean? And bring it to her church and sing on it while she's like singing the hymns or whatever with the choir. And then she'll come back to the crib and play it as she's cleaning the house. So I'm young, right? So I'm thinking like, my grandma's on the radio. Like, oh shit, you know what I mean? But not knowing that this is a tape recording, you feel me? So that's what really sparked my interest. Like, yo, I want to hear my voice through the speakers. I want to, you feel me?
Yeah. That's fire.
So it's real passion and love behind this.
So you were low-key one of those church babies.
A little bit. Yeah, I'd say that.
Because I'm always telling people, bro, the amount of people I've heard, the people that do melodic music, the amount of people I've heard that their origin was church and singing in choir or somehow like the way you were just saying, family members sing. That's always people's origins with that shit.
I never sang in a choir. I mean.
So you never did any like classes in high school, any music shit?
Nah.
Never played an instrument either?
Nah.
Damn. I'm surprised. Not really.
Everything is just more so just, you know, recording vocals.
Yeah.
Right? Yeah.
So how old were you at that point?
Man, I was probably like 9.
God damn. Like
9,
the first time you recorded?
Yeah.
God damn.
A tape recorder over a beat that's playing on the radio. I used to catch the end of the song. So, you know, end of the songs would have the beats playing. So I'll catch the end and record myself and do a quick 1-2 on it, man. You know what I mean? So that was my intro into the game until I got older and got a computer and programs, and just it all elevated from there. You feel me?
Damn. So when did you go to the studio for the first time?
Man.
Like an actual studio.
Yeah, I want to say it was a minute ago, bro. Probably like 2011, 2012. I went to the studio and just started, you know, I made my first record. It's in the email now, but, you know, it was definitely one of the moments that just had me interested and locked in doing music.
Damn. So were you one of those artists, like, you started recording and you just drop shit right away? Or did you more perfect your sound, take some time, figure out your brand, figure out what you wanted to do, construct a plan, then start dropping?
A little bit of both, man. You know what I mean? A little bit of both. I've gotten into that thing where, like, I I work on the craft and then not drop nothing, you know, like the Dr. Dre thing where, like, you know, he just won't drop as much because he's very so, you know what I mean, particular about his sound. Like, I've been in that mode, but I'm like, man, I still want people to hear me, you know what I mean? And, right. if it sucks and it sucks, then, you know, I'll make some other shit, you know what I mean? Right. I ain't afraid to fail.
What was your, like, biggest point of growth, would you say, early on in your career that you had to fuck up to learn?
Just, I think I'd probably say after that, me and PNB Rock had linked up. And I started to just know the business, you know what I mean, and try to grow in that space a little bit. You feel me? Like, damn, hold on, this is what artists go through. Damn, we don't see the money until we gotta get lawyers for this. Like, it's just a plethora of things. You feel me? Yeah.
Learning the business shit, bro. The layers to it. Like, I did a podcast with this dude from Morocco the other day. Actually,
yeah,
yeah, and he was telling me about all these business things, and I was like, bro, you think you know so much shit?
Yeah.
And then you just learn more and you're like, bro, I can never know all of this. And it's just so, there's so much shit out there that you're just completely unaware of, even when you think you know
what you're supposed
to be doing. You'll hear something and it just completely sways your direction and you're like, damn, this is really how this fucking business
is.
Yeah,
even me, shit. Yeah. I'm hip, like, I'm hip, man. So
it's fucked up.
I'd say a lot of my, and to go back to like your original question, I'd say like music, you know, I'm of Haitian descent. I'm Haitian. So, you know, I'd say like a lot of my come up and upbringing would just be, you know, listening to, you know, a lot of Kumpa and Zouk and just, you know what I mean, listening and looking at my family just enjoy this music to dance to, you know what I mean? And I'm like, I got to make some music that people feel.
That's fire.
Yeah.
That's fire. You talked about God Rest His Soul, PNB. You just brought that up. How did that even come about in the first place? Because was that early on in your career? Because the way you just made it sound like it was kind of early.
Yeah, it was like 2017, 2016, you know what I mean? His A&R had reached out, shout out Orlando Wurtenberg, SVP Atlantic Records. But he had reached out to me on Instagram. I had dropped a song on the SoundCloud called Miles. It was funny because he was out here for a little bit, and I think someone that knows him was out here fucking with a chick that was playing my music, you know what I mean? And then the dude was like, yo, who's this? Oh, it's Cat from Boston, check him out, da da da. So then 2-3 days later, I get a DM, you know what I mean? Go. You know what I mean? Like, I heard you, my man said that he heard you wanna, you know what I mean? Like, yo, let's link up, man. I like your pen. You know what I mean? Yeah. I said, yeah, you like my pen? Let's get up then, you know? And we got up, and then we had, I had met Rock, and we started vibing, bro.
Because you guys seem close from what I saw on Instagram.
Yeah, we started vibing. You know what I mean? I caught him early on. He caught me early on. You feel me? So
oh, shit, my bad.
No, it's all good. I'd say he's definitely the first one to really, like, help me put bread in my pocket when it came to this music shit.
That shit's fire.
Rest in peace, Rock.
I know, for real, dog. So he was like a mentor to you almost.
Yeah, early that's on. A big bro right there. Yeah.
Damn. So that's how the record. Because on your first project, you had a song with him.
Rose Gold, right? Man. Yeah. We had it was one of them things. We were just vibing in the studio. You know what I mean? We had made like mad records, and you know, he kept some, I kept some. It's one of those things.
Damn, that's fire. Did he? I should have looked into it before. Did he ever drop songs with you on it? I know.
As far as what?
Like that you were like featured on. You were
Nah. I dropped songs with him featured on it.
Yeah, that's because I saw you guys
on his end. You know what I mean? He dropped records that I helped kind of have my hand in. I say
because one of the ones you got a plaque with him, right?
Yeah, there she go. There she go, man. You know what I'm saying? Go plaque.
That shit is fire. How does it feel? Like, because we asked Zay. You know Isaiah Velmont?
Of course. We asked Zay
because we were asking him what his thoughts on plaques were like. How did it feel having a plaque? Was it worth the hype? Or after you got it, was it kind of like, damn?
Yeah. He's doing this thing with internet money. Shout out to Zay. But, yeah, man, it's worth the hype, bro. You got to understand, like, college dropout, man. That's my diploma, man. You feel me? Like, that's the reassurance that you're built for this. Okay. You feel me? So it's like, when I got that, I'm like, yeah, I'm built for this. It's time to get 10 more.
That's just fire.
Yeah.
That's just fire. You've got two other ones since, right?
It's on the way.
Okay.
That stuff takes months to kind of get together.
God damn. That shit's fucking crazy, though.
Hell yeah.
That shit's crazy. If you would have told your 9-year-old self when you were using that karaoke mic that you would even have a plaque in the first place, would you believe
it? I probably wouldn't, bro. I probably wouldn't believe it, man. I would, you know, I got, yeah, I probably wouldn't believe it, man. You know, this is a small state and that too much goes down out here. So, you know, I had to move to get that plaque. I had to move around to get that plaque. I had to go to New York to get that plaque. I had to go to L.A. So, hell no, I wouldn't have believed in it, man. But, you know, I'm blessed.
To backtrack a little bit, how we were just talking about your first project, Rose Gold. All right, was that was the name of the project,
Rose Gold.
Right? Yeah. How was it like putting out your first body of work, and how long were you dropping music before you put that project out? And how did you kind of construct everything?
So let's see, Rose Gold. I was putting out music probably about a year, 2 years before Rose Gold dropped. That's the thing, man. I was still trying to figure out my whole game plan with all this. Like, am I a single type artist, and am I an artist that drops a body of work, a cohesive body of work that makes sense, or am I just gonna be the guy that just drops fucking bangers every summer? You know what I'm saying? That comes, you know what I mean? That comes and goes. So, you know, I was playing around for 2 years trying to figure it out, and before the city, the state was just like, yo, bro, we need a body of work, man. Like, come on, man. We waiting, man. We need a body of work. So I just, you know, I put together some shit, man. Rose Gold. Took my whole life to make that album.
Was it nerve-wracking?
Hell yeah. Hell yeah.
I want to know that side of stuff.
It was very nerve-wracking because I'm like, dog, are they going to feel me, man? Like, are they going to like this? Are they going to get tired of my sound? Like, you know? But when I dropped it and it got real, real, real good reviews, I was like, yeah, we can keep doing this. You know what I mean?
Fire. Was there sort of I've been asking everyone this, shout out to Meech, because Meech was the first person to say it. Mm-hmm. Was it, and who was it? Oh, Fob was saying the pre side of it was worse, but do you think the pre-album anxiety was worse, or the post-album depression of being like, damn, I just worked on this for so long? Or do you not feel that with projects where it's like post-album depression? You
I don't
feel
that? That was a name, nah.
Yeah,
nah.
That's what Meech was describing it to me, and he was like putting it in the perspective for me, and I'm like, damn, I never really thought about projects like that.
Nah, man. Post album, I don't want to link depression to music too much, man. But what I will say is, that pre album anxiety is just it's real. Like, are people gonna feel this? It's, you know, what's the reviews gonna get? I feel like that's just with anything. You know what I'm saying? Before I rock a show, I get a little nervous. You know what I'm saying? Are they gonna feel me? Am I gonna bring the right energy? But once it's done, it's done. I don't really get depressed after that. For me, it's like, all right, what's next? What's next? You know, what's the climate right now with music? This is the fast pace. We're in the Jersey Club era. Things is fast. Yeah. Things is drill, everything. You know what I mean? Like, how do I fit into that space?
What's your thoughts on, like, how everything is just so rapidly fucking changing? Because I feel like everyone knows it, but literally the way that music has been, there's a sound, it gets beaten into the ground, then there's another sound, gets beaten into the ground, and it's literally just a constant cycle. Ever since fucking that era where the SoundCloud era fell off, trends, bro, that just get killed. They're so refreshing when they first come out. And then 2-3 months go by, and it's like, damn, bro, everyone sounds like this.
just keeping up with it. You know what I'm saying? Keeping up with it. And I think that's just the blessing of trying to establish your own sound. Once you reach that sound, you really don't worry about all that too much. You know what I'm saying? Because you're going to be in a space where you're different from what's hot right now. You know what I mean? So I don't really think nothing too much of it, man. But I like it. You know what I'm saying? I embrace it. You feel me? You know what I mean?
Traveling around, how much do you think that's helped you be able to adapt to these different circumstances? Because I want to touch on traveling. It's from the way you're making it sound, it seems like you've been fucking a lot of places.
I'm always on a plane, bro, at least once or twice a month. But
that's fine.
I traveling helps a lot, dog. One of my verses, I say, Aquafina water, I just flew right to Miami. The way your niggas singing, they just give boy your Grammy. That was on my song Miss Me that I had dropped in like 2018, 2017. But it was just, that was Aquafina water. I just flew right to Miami. You know, you're on a plane and you're looking down and you just see water. You just see land and shit. Like, so to answer your question, it just opens up my horizon and just new things to write about, different perspectives and shit.
What do you think the most eye-opening travel experience you've had is? If you had to name one trip that you would say, like, this caused the most dramatic shift in my work ethic, just me as a person, what trip would you point to?
I wouldn't say a trip per se. I would say more so, like, What I've done in mass, like, I say this to all artists, like, what you do where you're at right now, you got to do in the other 49 other states. You know what I'm saying? So I think the biggest eye opener for me was, shit, I got a long way to go. Like, you feel me? Like, damn, hold on. Like, when I'm in mass, I don't gotta, you know, wait in this line and do all these. I don't gotta do. You know what I mean? It was a little ego bruiser. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. But you know, I'd say overall, I can't pinpoint one trip per se, but I'd say, you know what I mean, when I leave mass, it just feels like I'm starting all over again. You know what I'm saying? And I think that's just what people need to hear.
That's a fire-ass outlook on that, bro. Some words of wisdom. Whoever's watching this shit, pay the fuck attention.
Sure, man. Get right. Move around.
Oh, God. So traveling, obviously, paying a big impact just on everything. But how have the different cultures been? Like, say you said you've been to Miami, L.A., and everything. What do you think there is in all these other states that Massachusetts doesn't have? Because obviously the music scene is dramatically gone up, and it's a way better scene than from what I've heard it's been in the past right now.
I wish I was around in 2016, boy. Shit would have been, you know what I mean? But I would say what I like what Mass is doing right now is there's more of this. There's more do-over-don'ts. There's more outlets, you know what I'm saying, where people can just, you know, come out and talk about their creations, you know what I'm saying? It's building over here on this side, you know what I'm saying? You're doing your thing. And but yeah, other places like LA, there's probably hundreds of these, you know what I'm saying? Atlanta, there's hundreds of these, you know. It's a little more unified, but I feel like we're getting to that. I'm not trying to, that whole stigma of we're not unified, I don't wanna just dwell on that too much, man. Let's change it and let's just work.
And I feel like that there's been a significant change with that too. Obviously there's like couple situations, there's a good amount of situations still with people butting heads or people just not showing each other love, but that whole people not showing love concept, I feel like it's changed a lot, especially over the past year. I feel like I've been seeing more people collaborate than ever. I feel a good majority of people, like there's a solid big circle kind of people that I feel like I just constantly see supporting each other. And I feel like that whole not showing love concept has kind of gone out the window a little bit over here.
I say it has. I mean, I can speak for myself. I can't speak on anyone. You know, I got regulars with Millie's, 8-Zip. These are just people from just different parts of the, you know what I'm saying, the state. You feel me? G Nipsey, you know, D the Flyers. I just try to just bridge the gap any way I can, man. You feel me? So I'm always down to work. If you got a wave, if you got a movement, and if you're serious about what you do, I fuck with you. You know what I'm saying? No money involved, that type of thing. You know? So that's just kind of how I see it. And but yeah, like you said earlier, man, we moving past that point a little bit. It's gotten a whole lot better. And, you know, whatever I could do to help, you know what I mean, stay the ship, shit, I'm with it. Hell yeah.
I wish everyone would stop having that in their heads, because I need to start saying this on every podcast. Mm-hmm. But whenever people say that recently, I've been trying to not check them, but be like, yo, like it's not really a thing anymore. Because that's literally what we're known for, I feel like, almost. And we need to stop pushing that agenda of, oh, we're known for not showing love, because exactly how you're saying it. If people keep thinking like that, it's going to just fucking stick around.
It's just a loser's mentality. Let's just work. You know what I'm saying?
Oh, God.
Hell yeah.
What do you think, though, besides just the significantly more amount that they have of places like this and stuff, what do you think it is that those other states really have that's really different from over here?
Other than just being the quantity of outlets?
Yeah, or do you think it's not even different besides that? You think there's
It's the work ethic. Yeah, I mean, the culture. I mean, you know, we're in like, what is it? It was a blue collar state or whatever, how you want to call it. I mean, we make the best out of it, man, you know what I'm saying? But yeah, we definitely have a culture. We're definitely a melting pot. It's Haitians, it's Spanish, it's you know what I'm saying, Jamaicans, it's Indians, you know. We can make shit happen. We can make it work. So I mean, the difference other than just where we are in the map, ain't really much of a difference. We just got to put the work in. That's just my whole mindset on things, bro.
It's just everyone has to put the work in.
Yeah, hell yeah.
We have more popping artists than ever right now, too.
What?
Like, we do. Like, the scene right now is at such a good place. I've only been in this scene for, like, almost 4 years now. I've lost track of time. It's three or four years.
Right. It goes by fast.
It goes by fast as shit, but just the amount of change that I've seen while I'm in it, it's just fucking beautiful.
Bro. Yeah, man, it is. A lot of people doing that thing. You know, you got Joyner Lucas, Bia. Joyner shows me a lot of love. Shout out to Joyner. Bia shows me love. Shout out her, too. You know what I mean? People doing their thing. Cousin Stiz, everybody. Van Boys, they doing their thing. They moving.
Shout out VB. There's so many people right now. Do you think there will ever, because we were having this debate in the group chat the other day, like we were all engaged in this debate.
Yeah.
Do you think there will ever be a Massachusetts sound? Or here's what we were debating on. We were saying the beauty of the Massachusetts scene is the fact that it's a melting pot and you have all these different sounds coming out and there's not like one sound. But do you think that will be what gets us to where we need to be? Or do you think we kind of need to develop the Boston sound if we really want to put Mass on the map? I'm going to say, I need to stop saying Boston, Massachusetts. But correct myself, Massachusetts.
I'm trying to think about other areas and other regions that have a sound, and they do. I mean, I've never really focused in on like a Mass sound per se, you know what I mean? It's more so just different artists that have their different sounds that's doing the best they can to push it, you feel me? And I feel like everything else will work itself out, man. You know what I mean? I don't want to focus more too much on just like how we sound. It's just more so how we grind. You know what I'm saying? Let's come together. Okay, you got that sound over there. You doing the punk rock rap. Well, I'm doing the melodic. How do we blend that together and make something magical? Yeah. I mean, or you doing the hardcore gangster rap over here? Well, shit, how do we mesh the R&B? You know what I mean? How do we do that? You know what I mean? So that's kind of where my mind's at for real.
Damn. So you're on the side of thinking it's more the melting pot that's going to get us.
Hell yeah, bro. That shit. Hell yeah, man.
I think that's going to be the thing that blows us up, too, because it's just beautiful. I was just talking about it was beautiful. All the artists you just named, some of them make music that you could consider somewhat similar, but for the most part, they're all completely different. And everyone, I feel like over here, the people that are really in the shit, they're just so focused on just being themselves and standing out, and that's not what they're doing, is trying to make something that fits in. So I feel like that might be, that's probably going to be how it goes.
Who knows, man?
We'll see, though, because I'm telling you, the next, like, I think this year alone, a lot of really game-changing shit is going to happen in the community. Mm-hmm. But never mind a five-year span, I feel like we're going to see that period where it's all eyes on us. Like, how Atlanta's had, New York's had, Jersey's having right now. Like, that shit is going to come for us eventually, and I feel like it's
about the unity, for sure.
Yeah, I feel like that shit's around the corner, bro.
It's all about the unity, the features, people showing love, you know what I'm saying? Like, when I had dropped my Not My Fault record a year and a half ago, Bia put it on her Instagram, showed me love. Fire. You know what I mean? I'm like, damn, see, we get more of that, we'll be all right. You know what I'm saying? God. You got to be consistent with it, to unify.
Oh, my God. Because people, what pisses me off, too, and anyone watching this podcast, fucking listen to this. Everyone's always complaining about how the people who are, quote, unquote, up aren't showing love to anybody. And I see, like, the shit you just described of Bia. I see Millie's doing the shit like that. I see a bunch of artists that are in positions where they're established already doing that shit around here. And if you're complaining about that, just work harder. Because what I see them doing, every single person that I've been seeing artists like that give shout outs to and stuff, it's deserved. It's not there's some fucking dude sitting in their bedroom. It's no, they just worked their ass off for mad long and actually did some shit that was dope. Like,
For sure.
I feel like that's, people are always complaining about that too, is how the artists don't trickle down their connections and show love to people that are not where they are yet, but I be seeing that shit happen all the time, bro. And I feel like Boston, that's something that the artists that are in the positions are really good at. Like, even Stiz showing love with VB and shit. There's so many different artists that are doing that shit.
I was on the Stiz show this past August, too.
You were on the Stiz show? That shit's fire.
It was me, Stiz, and VB. You know, shout out to Stiz. That's my man right there, man. When I go to LA, I pull up on him, you know what I'm saying, kick it out of his crib, you know what I mean, play the 2K. But, dog, I'd say you hit the nail on the head with that, bro. You feel me? You know, it's I try to stay away from the whole handout mentality. Like, hey, show me, you know what I mean?
It just comes natural. Yeah, it comes like, natural. It's not like you're going to fucking DM Millies and beg him to fucking post you on Instagram. That shit's not going to work. Just, like, naturally do what you need to do.
Exactly. Like, speaking of Millies, there was one time I had a pull up, and I'm cool with Millies, but, you know what I mean? I still got to, hey, you know, oh, he's in New York? All right, well, shit, I'm not going to hit him. I'm going to just pop up to New York and see what happens. You know what I'm saying? Like, that's just kind of how I move, and you know what I mean? I did it a few times, and it's worked. They show love, man. You know, they want to see the I don't want to just put it on him, but artists just want to see another artist working hard, too. We don't want to feel like we're just, okay, here. You know what I'm saying? Unless you signed to me type shit. But other than that, man, you know, you got to put some work in, too.
Oh, God.
You know what I'm saying?
Why do you think so many artists feel entitled as fuck? Because that's a common theme, bro, that's been coming up on this podcast a lot.
I mean, but you mean entitled as far as what? Like, just getting a handout?
This,
like,
girl, Zahila, I forget the exact quote, but I'm going to try to quote you.
Yeah.
On her podcast, she was basically saying, she's like, you got to understand, because she was saying how there's artists that have been doing this shit for like 6 months and will be like, oh, I expect a feature from you or you to post me on Instagram. And then she was like, what you don't see is that I've dedicated 10, 15 years of my life to this shit. And you've been doing it for 6 months and you want to come think that you just deserve this right away.
Right.
Like, what do you think why do you think so many artists just feel like, oh, like, I don't even know you from a hole in the wall, but you should give me a feature just because, like, whatever.
I'm trying to think, man. I don't think no one's ever really came at me like that. Yeah. It's business. Like, you know what I'm saying? I'm like, you really want the feature? Okay, what's your budget? But, you know, I don't know, man. I've never been one of those artists. I'm just so humble. Yeah. I stay in my lane, bro. You feel me? But, I mean, I don't know. That's something within them they got to figure out, man. I can't speak to that. I don't know. Yeah. I don't feel like entitled to anything. For me, I just feel like I gotta make my presence felt. You know what I'm saying? Cats are dying every day, you know what I'm saying? You know, shit, something happened to me, I wanna leave some shit behind. You know what I'm saying? Music, you feel me? So yeah, man, I can't speak to the entitled part, man. But hey, if there's an artist that does feel that way, my only advice would be work hard, man. Work harder, don't feel entitled to nothing. No one owes you shit. Why? You know what I'm saying? That's kinda how I see it.
People do not understand that.
Nobody owes you shit, man. Nobody owes you shit, dog.
I feel like the second you realize that, too, is when you'll thrive.
Yeah.
The people that are like that, if you realize nobody owes you shit, like, I don't know.
Yeah, dog, yeah. You know what I'm saying? So that's kind of how I like to live life, and that's my whole philosophy and all that. Yeah.
Talking about Well, actually, no, not talking about that. I want to backtrack a little bit because I meant to talk about this. We just got sidetracked completely. Yeah. Not sidetracked. We were doing the interview questions that were supposed to come before.
Yeah.
But I want to get into the fact that you got a project coming out soon.
Yeah.
I want to get into that. I want you to just elaborate. Say the name again.
Rose from Nothing. Rose from Nothing, man. RFN.
Rose from Nothing.
Yeah, yeah.
So
Rose from Nothing.
What can people expect on that? Like, what's the vibe? What's the vibe they could expect, and then whatever other information you want to give out.
So the vibe with this one is gonna be more so I'm just connecting back to my roots, man. So my first album was more pain, like come up, like, you know what I'm saying, I was broke, this is all new shit to me, like that kind of thing. I mean, when you listen to Rose Gold, you hear a kid that's just being exposed to so much, you know what I'm saying. When you listen to Playboy, the song, the album I got with Jon Glass, you know what I mean, you know, you hear someone who's evolved and grown, you know what I'm saying.
Wait, Jon Glass produced that whole project?
Yeah. Oh yeah.
Shout out John, bro.
Jon Glass, he's a man.
I don't want to get sidetracked. I want you to keep it. But Jon Glass, bro, fucking salute to you. That is like the nicest dude I have ever met. So fucking smart, bro. He literally, me, Sully, and KZ, that conversation we had with you the night we did your interview, you literally changed like our perspective on life. And I have never heard anybody say anything bad about you, and I have so much fucking respect. Like, that man, bro, he is one of my favorite people I've met through this shit. Shout out Jon Glass, bro.
Glass is solid. But nah, my bad. He did five out of the seven five records, but that's damn near the whole thing.
Yeah, you know, so, still shout out Jon,
you know, he's definitely changed my whole perspective, too, on music, man.
Bro,
we found each other when I was really just trying to figure out, like, I didn't want to drop the same album multiple times, you feel me? So for me, I'm like, well, sonically, I didn't want to just do the same sounds.
Yeah.
So I got up with Glass. I'm like, hey, man, I love rap. I love R&B, man, but, I mean, you know, I want to switch it up, man. And, you know, Glass, he's one of those guys where it's like he'll talk to you. He'll break, you know, he'll try to get inside your mental, like, as far as, like, yo, so how you feeling? All right, what you been listening to? You know what I'm saying? It almost feel like a therapy session when we first link up before we get up. You know what I'm saying? So, and I'll tell him, yo, bro, I'm feeling like kind of 80s right now. I've been watching a lot of 80s movies. I'm in, you know, Godfather, you know, mafia shit. I mean, like, how about I make a love song, like a love soundtrack to that era? And then he'll start playing me old school type retro vibes. And, you know, I'll sing to them, I'll rap to them. And, you know, we made a body of work that worked.
Shout out Jon Glass, bro.
Jon Glass, he's a legend, man.
Oh, God. I got to get to your studio still, bro. I feel bad. I've been trying it so far away, and I work at, like, 11 o'clock at night, so I have, like, a little window in between. But yeah. I'm going to get over there in the next month. I'm promising you.
It's fine. You got, like, five rooms, man. Nowhere Studios, man.
Yeah, shout out Nowhere Studios, too, bro. But to continue on, because you were saying, basically, the first vibe was just you being exposed to everything. And then what was the vibe on Playboy? Because I think we got cut off there.
Yeah. So Playboy was just more so, you know, it was love. It was a lot of just retro vibes and just me tapping into a different pocket, man. You know what I mean? I wanted to see what the commercial pocket sounded like. You know what I mean? And it worked, man. I was on the radio a lot. You know what I mean? Shout out DJ Foreign, man. Jam 945, DJ Foreign, man. Foreign Exchange. You know, he supported me a lot. He was spinning Not My Fault a lot. DJ Papa Don. Shout out DJ Papa Don, too. You know what I mean? So, yeah, man. So this album is going to be more so just getting back to my roots, more so pain. You know what I'm saying? A lot of the stuff I had to endure. Fatherhood, you feel me? So these are things that changed within the spans of me dropping the album. So just pretty much updating the city, you know what I mean, the region of what I've been up to.
I want to know, because I asked Gio this question, how dramatic of an impact has that been, being a father? Like,
Man, it just makes you take life a whole lot more serious.
Yeah, I can imagine.
I take time serious. I take, you know, even before I got here, I'm like, oh man, I want to be on time, but I gotta hit the gym. All right, man, I gotta get my physical right before I come here, because if I come here without, you know what I'm saying, hitting the gym, I'm gonna be all sluggish. Let me just, so, you know, I'd say fatherhood just made me more focused and more driven, for real. You know what I'm saying, and more just afraid to get out of my comfort zone. This is why I tapped in with you when I hit you, because I think you had hit me up like around October, and I really wasn't ready at the time. You know what I'm saying? I'm like, I don't know, man. I'm not ready to really talk on podcast right now. But then, yeah, bro, fatherhood just turned me up.
So you feel like it gave you that extra little kick of motivation that you needed?
Yeah. Then. You really just get with the times. So I'm like, man, you know, this is what the state needs, and for me to not be a part of it is just a crime. I got to be a part of it.
Damn, bro.
Oh, yeah.
But do you feel like it didn't slow the music down at all?
As far as what, like, did it slow the music down?
Yeah.
Nah. I mean, in what sense? You know, I'd say, like, dropping music, maybe, but, you know, right, being in the right space, nah. I was turned up.
Yeah, damn,
I was turned up. I was hopping on an Amtrak to New York every weekend.
God damn. You know what
I'm saying? I was hopping on an Amtrak from Mass to New York every weekend, no B&B, no plan, just out. I'm out here. Now I'm reaching out to my contacts. I'm out here just hoping and praying one of them be like, oh, yeah, sure, pull up. You feel me? So, yeah, you know, that's the grind.
Talking to you, bro, like this whole conversation, it just kind of came to me. You just have that hustler ambition, like, fucking embedded into you. Where did that come from? Like, when do you feel like your hustler mentality really came about, or do you feel like it's just always been there since you were young, young?
It wasn't always there, man. I was a shy boy, man. A shy boy. I'd say I started reading more, well, listening to more audiobooks, 50 Cent, you know, a lot of, I'm a huge 50 Cent fan.
I got to read that shit, bro. I got it for Christmas.
You got it?
I got it, bro. I be reading books all the time, and I got that.
Life, bro.
I got that shit and a Fat Joe book for Christmas.
I got it. Okay, the Jose one. Yeah. I got to tap in with that one. But yeah, nah, I would say, you know, just, you know, 50 Cent, someone who I idolized since 2002. You feel me? So his grind from video games to this to that. That's why when I would mirror it with mine, like, all right, well, artist, okay, writing, you know what I'm saying? Eventually I want to try acting, you know, but yeah, man, just not settling, bro. Got one life to live, and I think that's what really turned up my ambition and my vibe. Like, dog, you know, every time I'm sitting on the couch, bro, and I'm just flicking through some shit, I'm like, oh, man, I could be doing so much more with my time, man. Let me get out. Like, I see why Tom Brady hopped out of retirement after 2 weeks, man. Like, you don't want to sit at home, bro. You feel me?
Damn, bro. So you feel like reading, though, that was a big drive? Like, just learning from, obviously, you just said 50 Cent, but you feel like reading as a whole kind of gave you that hustler's ambition?
Yeah. Right. It's more out there. It's more out there. So why not go see it? You know what I'm saying? Why not go experiment? I would say for me, my fear of failing was something that kept me from really doing what I really wanted to do. I mean, but now it's like, all right, I blocked that out. Now I'm really just trying to get out here and figure it out even more. You know what I'm saying? Hence why I'm here, man. Do it or don't.
I want to know your top three books that you feel like played a dramatic role in just like you as a person in general.
Yeah.
Top three.
So the 48 Laws of Power.
Everyone's always saying that one. I still haven't read that one. That's the one. But everyone's always fucking gassing that book up.
Art of Not Giving a Fuck.
I fucking love, bro. I always recommend for people to read that fucking book, bro. That is a fucking. Did you read the second one?
Nah.
There's one. Everything is Fucked, I think it's called. I read everything that one too. It's Everything is Fucked. There's
a part two to that. Okay. Man, and the 50 Cent one. The 50 Cent one. Hell yeah. I forget the name. He was sitting on a chair. Damn, what's the name of that joint?
Bro.
Ah, man.
I got that shit last Christmas too, bro. Or no, I got it for my birthday actually. So you I've had that shit since May.
Okay.
I've had that shit since May and I haven't read it, bro. I need to fucking read that shit.
The 50 Cent book, I was at the gym. I was going through some stressful shit. I was like, it was like 3 a.m. I was working out. Some kid comes up to me, young boy too, pulled up on me like, hey, man. Yo, I see you really putting in work on the weights or whatever. Like, you feel me? I was like, yeah. I don't know. Maybe it looked like I was going through some shit, man. You know what I mean? Yeah. He was like, yo, check this book out, man. It's really helped me out a lot. Young kid, boy. I'm like, I was like, what? So I put it on, and I'm just like, yo, it just opened my eyes to a whole new thing. Like, yo, I'm not working hard enough. You know what I'm saying? You can work hard, but there's someone out there working harder than your heart. You know what I'm saying? So that's what really got me going, man. You know, hopping on Amtrak. You know what I'm saying? You know, just going out to the Big Apple, trying to figure some shit out, trying to lock some shit in, getting with different A&Rs. You know what I'm saying? So, yeah, bro. Yeah, music is my passion, man. I love music, man.
I got to read that 50 Cent book, bro. Got to. I got to read that 50 Cent book. Mm-hmm. How you said you were shy at one point, though. You an introvert or an extrovert?
I say introvert for real.
You're an introvert?
Yeah. I'm only extrovert when it's music time, when it's time to drop. You feel me? But the Roddy Riches, the A Boogies, the cats that don't really, you know what I mean, be out there too much. But, you know, you feel their presence when they're out.
Yeah. How do you recommend for artists that are introverts or just people in this industry in general that are introverts and they're shy, they don't feel like going out, networking, going to shows, doing all this shit? What do you recommend for them to do to get over that?
Shit, man. Just dig deep and, you know, don't be afraid, man. You know what I'm saying? Like, I had to really tell myself at one point, like, yo, what am I doing? I get mad respect out here. Why am I? Man, let me get out the fucking house, man. You know what I mean? Like. Just get out there, man. For sure. Just do it. Like Nike, man. I mean, there's really no science to it. Just get out there and do it.
Do over don't. Do over don't.
Yeah. I like
do
what you did there.
I had a question that I was about it. Oh, how I was talking about the plaques, and then we were talking about 9-year-old you wondering if you got that. You were just talking about how the EP that you, or was it an EP or was it a full
Playboy? Playboy was an EP. RFN's going to be like, you know, it's going to be 15, 20 tracks.
Bet.
Yeah.
But I was saying with the EP that you did with Jon, how was it? Was that the first time you heard your songs on the radio before?
Nah, my first time I had records on the radio too.
So what was it like the first time you ever heard your song on the radio? And I'm assuming it was 94.5.
Yeah, for sure. Nah, it was actually a Boston based station. It was a Boston based station, which was dope. I think it was like 86 something, I forget. Once I hit the jamming though, it was dope. I was on the launch pad. Shout out DJ E Double, man. You know what I'm saying? Real pioneer in the game. But DJ E Double was spinning my shit heavy, man. He was really fucking with me for real. Spinning my shit all the time. I had a record called Miles. I'm gonna go ahead and put some miles on her. I'm gonna go ahead and put some miles on her. Don't matter what it is, she hold it down for me. Like, that was the record he was loving, man. He was spinning that shit all the time. I would get Snapchats of, like, dudes hitting me up, like, yo, bro, I just fucked the baddest bitch to your shit, man. Like, for real, dog. Yo, keep it up, man. I'm like, hey, I'm happy I got you some play, dog. You know what I'm saying? But, yeah, that felt good. It was surreal to me, man, because the launch pad is, like, I think it's, like, more so, like, a lot of cats that's locked up hear that time, you know what I mean? It's a place from, like, Sunday from, like, 10 p.m. to, like, 1 a.m. or whatever. So, like, you know, DJ Double would call me, like, yo, bro, a lot of requests for this, bro. Like, you know what I'm saying? You really get a lot of niggas through their time. Like, hey, man, that's what I do it for, man, just to help someone that, you know what I'm saying, you're going through some shit. If the music lifts your spirits to help you get through whatever you're going through, my job is done. You know what I'm saying? So it felt fulfilling to answer your question.
That shit's crazy. I remember because how I said we dropped albums. We had one song played the first time we dropped the album, and I was just like, damn, bro, I used to listen to this shit on the ride to school, like, every fucking day, and then hearing it for the first time on 94.5, I was like, what the fuck?
Yeah. You're right.
Yeah, no, like, what do we do over don't? Like, we drop collaborative projects. We just get a bunch of artists. Basically, that's how we started a studio. So I rented out a whole entire campground.
Yeah.
Like, bunch of, basically, just picture, like, some Camp Crystal Lake type shit.
Right.
On bumfuck Massachusetts, like, way out by Amherst and shit.
Oh, out there.
Way out there, on a lake. Like, 10-bedroom, like, campground. Like, literally bunk beds in the rooms and shit. We set up, like, 3 or 4 studios. We got, like, there was, like, 35 or 40 artists in and out throughout the whole weekend. But we got 27 artists on the project, 5 producers, and we made an 18-song album in 3 days.
Damn, son. Yeah. 18-song album in 3 days.
Yeah.
I like that.
That's the first time we got on 94.5.
Set up shop, man. Set up shop. How long ago was that? That was some time ago?
That was 2020.
That was
2020.
Okay. Yeah,
that was like November. It was like mid-COVID. Mid-COVID.
Let's do it, man. Time to run it up again.
That shit. We're going to do one soon. I think we're about to dabble in the single routes. Also, too, be on the lookout. We're about to do fucking every quarter for the rest of the year. We're dropping projects that we basically do all the marketing from scratch, all the beats from scratch with a different artist every quarter. We just started working on... We already have the first one basically done because we worked on it last year.
Yeah.
And we're working on the one for the second quarter with this artist, Tier, right now. It's a female artist.
That's hard. I'm going to write for a female artist, man.
Have you never wrote for a female artist before?
I'm trying to, man. Nah. I'm in a couple of DMs right now. You know what I'm saying?
Go through
the Pink World
playlist.
Yeah. Pink World playlist.
Pink World, all the girl podcasts that we'd be doing, bro. Yeah. You'll find some fire ass fucking artists, bro. Who did we interview? Oh, Key, bro. Shout out Key, bro. They did like a 2-hour because he shot for a couple times. You know who Key is?
The Atlanta rapper?
Nah, she's from here. Kiwi Fruit. You ever seen her IG?
Nah.
Yo, she's like a Rico Nasty type artist, bro.
Okay.
Yo. Her stage presence, I've watched her perform like 3 times right now. No disrespect to anyone else because I haven't seen that many performances. She is probably the best performer out of Mass right now.
She's
probably the best performer out of Mass. But they did a 2-hour podcast with her yesterday, and I got mad respect for that girl.
That's fire.
But I'm trying to think. The Tier girl I mentioned, Allie Duty, there's mad. If you go through the Pink World playlist, you'll just see mad girl artists from around there. I was going to say, though, what's your creative process like in general? Because obviously, I feel like the way that I've heard people talk about you, you're like one of the most respected writers around here. So do you ever freestyle shit, or do you always just, when you're going in the booth, you're writing some shit beforehand or writing it there?
I'm still a notepad guy, man.
You write on physical paper?
I don't got the checkbook no more. But my process, I literally go in there. And I freestyle first as far as, like, I lay down a blueprint. I like to call it the blueprint. I lay down a blueprint. It'll be a bunch of melodies, a bunch of just slur, you know what I mean, a bunch of mumble jumbo.
Yeah.
But I could hear what, you know what I mean, I could hear. It's a gift, man. I could hear what I'm trying to say. And then I take the blueprint, and I just sit with it for a little bit and then put the words on it after. So I literally just write the words on it after just so it could all make sense for real.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? So, yeah, and that's what I was doing with Rock, man. I was in a booth. And then we played, we had the beat. My man Busy Genius made the beat. Shout out Busy Genius. He sent me the beat. It was really originally for me. And then I played it for Rock. So, yo, Rock, yo, you know what I'm saying? What you think about this? And he's like, I feel this, but I don't really got, you know what I mean? I'm like, I got you. When going in the booth. Every time she walked by, I'll be like, there she go. Every time she walked, now he's singing it. Now we're singing it together in the room. And then, you know, he's laying, you know, we're just kind of, I'm throwing bars, at, he's throwing bars in it. You know what I mean? We're just kind of just cold, you know what I mean? Making some hits, you feel me? So my process is more so like that, man. You know what I mean? Just, yo, whatever the beat tells us to do, we're going to do it.
Yeah. So you feel like the beat is the most influential part when you're trying to make a song?
Of course. It is. Our producers, man. Hell yeah.
How do you feel, talking about traveling earlier, how do you feel like the environment you're in affects your creative process?
I'd say it pushes me to the limit. So it's funny because when I'm, I had pulled up to Philly to get with Rock, but he wasn't there. But I still pulled up anyway to get with like the other artists, just to feel the atmosphere. I ain't never really been to Philly before. And I was in the stew. I had met with Leaf Ward. You know what I'm saying? Shout out Leaf Ward. I think he dropped the project too. Shout out him. But yeah, man, I was in the stew with him and a whole bunch of other guys, man. The energy was just so different, man. I'm like, yo, damn, this is crazy. I see guys with the, you know what I'm saying, you know, the big beards and the, you know what I mean, the shit with the Muslim hat on and all that. You know what I'm saying? I'm like, yo, this is different over here. This is crazy different over here. Boy, I'm like, damn. I'm like, you know what? Well, fuck it, though. I'm going to rock out, you know? And then they started playing beats and I started singing to them. I'm like, I don't know if they're going to feel this over here. But they felt it, man. They were like, yo, oh, you nice. You nice, man. Yo, yeah, you nice, Neff. They say Neff out there. Yo, Neff, you nice. I'm like, yo, appreciate it, man. But I say it pushes me to the limit, though. When I'm in other places, other hoods, other studios, there's a fire in me that's like, yo, you gotta be the best in this room, dog. You gotta represent for your state.
That shit's fire.
Hell yeah.
That shit's fire.
It's a crazy pressure that I'm proud to put on my back.
Here's a funny question, because you were just talking about a studio session that I'll be asking people. Mm-hmm. What's your worst experience in the studio ever? Without saying names, if you don't want to throw anyone on the bus, and I'm sure there's some stories you can't tell. But if you had to say one terrible studio experience that you could put out there, name it.
Man, it's terrible studio. Man, I don't know, bro. I never really had nothing crazy happen in the studio. Nah, man. I would say, you know, just getting criticism. That same story I was telling you about going to Philly, I was playing some records for PNB's manager. His name Mott. Shout out Mott. I was playing records for Mott. And I got like over like 2,000 records, dog. You know what I'm saying?
God damn.
So I'm playing these records, and the first 10, he just wasn't feeling. And I'm like, he was like, yo, Neff, nah, you gotta come harder. So I'd say like stuff like that would be like, oh, that's a bruiser. You know what I'm saying? But then I'd be like, oh, no, you're like this. Okay, that's better. You know what I'm saying? So I'd say when I really don't come prepared and I feel like I don't bring my A game, that's when I'm hard on myself. And that's for me is like the worst. Damn. Session for me.
I'm surprised you don't have any horror stories. Nah, like, with how long you've been doing stuff, bro? You're blessed.
I go to studio. Oh, honestly, bro, I like to go to studios like alone, for real. Damn. You know what I'm saying? Like, I'll be alone or just be like me, it'll be me and the engineer me and the artist I fuck with, whatever. So when I'm in a setting where there's other people, I turn up a lot. You know what I'm saying? Like, that's when like the fire is like, I gotta come with it, man. I don't want no one to tell me that's just trash. Like, you know what I'm saying? Yeah.
How long would you say that it took you until you could accept other people's criticisms? Because I feel like most people's downfalls is they can't take criticism. And I feel like to a point, almost everybody is built in you to not take criticism at first, and you kind of have to like fight it. I don't know if that's, I'm not speaking for everyone, but I'm speaking for myself. It took me a while to adapt to being able to take criticism for people.
It took me a while too, bro. I ain't gonna cap. It took me a while. I was a... I, you know, in the beginning, I thought everything I was doing was hot because, you know, the city was loving it. The state's loving it. But, you know, it got to a point where, you know, the people I got about like 5 people who I sent songs to for just, hey, what do you think? You know what I'm saying? And then once I started getting some pushback, like, come on, man, we heard this already. Yeah, you know what I mean? I think we got to come different. What are you talking about, bro? This is fire. Like, I'm you know what I mean? I'm tight now. I'm like, nah, you tripping, bro. Then I'll go and drop it. I got less views than the last one. All right, bro's right. You know what I'm saying? Let me just, you know, let me come a little different. Let me come a little harder. So, it took me a little bit, man. But that's an ego thing. You know what I'm saying? And I had to, once I got to keep that in check, things got better.
What do you think humbled you the most along your path?
To go back to just, you know what I'm saying, being out of state, and then just being treated like I'm not Rosewood Bait, you know what I'm saying? You know what I'm saying? So that humbles me a lot, bro. I'm trying to tell you, man, like, just, you know what I mean? It's like, nah, this wouldn't happen if I was in Mass. What you mean? We gotta pay to get in? Like, what? Like, bro, we still gotta grind, bro. I'm like, for real? Ah, you feel me? So it's like, it's little shit like that humbled me, man. So I look for humbleness in a lot of different places. Yeah.
How'd you come up with the name?
Rosewood Bait, man. All right. So it's a couple of things, bro. It's a couple of things. But Kanye really played a pivotal role in that. Kanye West. I don't know if you remember, but it was like 2010, 2011.
His Bape era?
Nah. He was rocking suits. He was rocking suits with the glasses.
Yeah.
So that whole style was called Rosewood.
Really?
Yeah. If you look, it's like Rosewood Taylor and all that shit.
I didn't even know that.
Man. That's how much of a nerd I am, low key. I'm like, what's he rocking? What's he doing, man? And
I used to be like that when I was younger.
Exactly. Yeah. And then he had a cipher. BET cipher. It was like him, Common, Big Sean, Sahada Prince.
I gotta see that shit. How have I never seen that?
Push what? A T.
What? I'm like a Kanye fucking super fan.
Oh man, bro, it was a BET cipher, man.
I gotta see
this
shit.
2010, 2011 type shit. And
I gotta see that shit.
It was before he had went on, Pusha T killed his verse. You know what I mean? Everyone was killing their cyphers. And then Kanye went on last, and before he went off, he was like, Rosewood. The plan was, but what's worse, the pain or the hangover? Too many circles on your team, that's why your win's low. Like, I'm like, oh, this nigga spitting, you know what I mean? But I heard that, I'm like, what's Rosewood? So I looked it up, I literally typed in Rosewood and Kanye West, you know what I'm saying?
Damn.
And then it just all came up, and I'm like, all right, this is smooth, and I'm a smooth guy. Like, I'm gonna take that. And at the time, I was writing a lot of Bapes. When I sold it, what had me just made it popular. I was in middle school rocking the Bapes. I got me some bathing apes. I was on that early, boy. I was on that early, man. And, they started calling me Bape. So I just put the two together. And then my Twitter handle in 2011 was Rosewood Bape.
Damn.
And that just stuck with me ever since, man.
That's fire. Mm-hmm. That's fire. Yeah. What would you say your favorite clothing brands are now? Is Bape still in there?
It's still Bape. It's still Bape. Hell yeah. I like Bape. I like Supreme. I like...
You like what they're doing recently, though?
I haven't tapped in recently. Yeah.
Were you one of the ones waiting on the laptop at 11 in the morning every Thursday? Weren't?
Nah. I'm not that much of a hype with this shit, man. I used to be, bro. If it comes to me, it comes to me, man. But I really like lately, you know, what I get. I've been on that cozy Fear God essential shit. That's just fire. So, man.
The cozy vibes, bro.
Cozy vibes. You know what I mean? Baggy, all that shit. I'm like, oh, yeah, I can get with this. Yeah. I like that, you know?
Fashion trends change just as fast as the fucking music does, bro. Because I remember that period when everyone was wearing fucking skin-tight, skinny jeans, leather jeans and shit. When Kanye was dropping Yeezus, now fucking...
I couldn't fit into those shits, bro.
Bro, that era, bro. When everyone was wearing fucking the extra-long shirts, bro, looking like fucking anime characters and shit.
Yeah. I mean, I definitely used to sport the 4XL tees and shit, man. Bro. You know, but that was like the crunk era for me, like when people were snapping and rolling and shit, man. You know what I mean? Yeah,
bro. Fashion trends are crazy. Fashion trends are crazy.
For sure.
What are your other hobbies besides music? Your little love for clothes. What would you say your other hobbies are outside of music?
Just building entrepreneurship, bro. You know what I'm saying?
Shit.
My man just bought like an 18-wheeler truck.
God damn.
You know what I'm saying? And he's doing his thing with that. So, you know what I mean? I'm trying to learn about that a little bit. Yeah. Just build entrepreneurship, owning shit. You know what I'm saying? Learning. You know what I mean? Rest in peace, Nipsey Hussle. But, you know, he's one of the artists that I like to follow. You know, even still, right? You know what I mean? So I was just following what he was doing. You know what I'm saying? Building stores, opening up stores. You know what I'm saying? So
doing shit like
I'm still learning in that space, though. I ain't really locked in. You know what I'm saying? Because, you know, the music space is still something that I'm doing and pursuing and putting my all in. But outside of that, when I get the music a little break, I'm like, all right, man, how do I own some shit? Let me start something, man. You know what I'm saying? Rosewood Estates. That's what I want to do, man. Rosewood Estates, fire. Man. Build a condominium, you know what I mean?
That shit's fire.
Hell yeah.
That shit's fire. You watch movies or anything?
Not too much. But for the most part, the classics. None of the new Johns. I just seen the Wakanda joint last week.
I didn't see that shit yet, bro. I still need to see that shit.
That was cool.
You seen the new Avatar?
Nah, man, I ain't peeped that.
That shit was fire, except for the fact that it was 3.5 hours.
Yeah, that shit was
damn near 4 hours. I think it was like 3 hours and 40 minutes or some shit.
Oh, shit.
But that shit was good.
Yeah, man. Nah. I ain't gonna lie. I like a lot of mafia shit, man. I don't really watch the
Scarface or Godfather.
Ah, man. I'm gonna give it the Scarface.
Good.
You know what I mean?
If you answer Godfather, you answer wrong.
Yeah. You know what I mean? The Cuban that made turn that into something. Come on, like that's the story. Like I love that. I love that type of story.
Menace to Society or Boys in the Hood?
Oh man, Menace to Society or Boys in the
Hood? You're answering. Let's see.
Damn, son.
You answered the first one right.
I'm gonna have to take a shot for this one. Yeah. For real. I would say. I gotta give it the Boys in the Hood. Man.
Damn, bro. I'd say Menace.
You say Menace.
I love Menace,
you like,
bro.
You like the Hurry Up and Bye? All right.
I love Menace.
I gotta give it the Boys in the Hood, man. Only because, you know, that was a time where Ice Cube was still doing his thing. He had just left NWA, I think, and he was still dropping like albums, and he was screenwriting. He wrote the movie script. You know what I'm saying? So knowing the background of it definitely plays a part in that decision. You know what I'm saying? Hell yeah. That entrepreneurship, man.
We need like more modern, like mafia gangster movies, bro.
We need more of those, like, Jones,
we need more of those, bro.
Yeah.
I feel like the world's too soft for them shits to be dropped. Did you watch? I didn't watch it, but the Irishman. I know mad people were praising that shit.
Nah, I gotta give it. I did give it a chance. It started slow for me.
Yeah,
so I lost interest a little bit. But I'm gonna tap back in. I'm just right now. I'm locked in on the 50 shows, man. BMF, Power, Kanan, all that.
You watch Snowfall?
Hell yeah! I think it's coming back.
Yeah,
it's coming back, right?
I think I'm like a season behind right now, but Snowfall is mad fire. Snowfall,
that shit is hard.
Yeah, Snowfall is hard. Crazy, bro. I want them to make you watch Narcos Mexico?
Nah, but I seen the first one though. Is that the first one?
Nah, Narcos is the one with Pablo. Narcos Mexico.
Yeah, that's the one I finished.
Yo, the Mexico shit. Not to like spoil it too much, but basically the past three seasons, it was the first two seasons were Felix Gallardo.
Mm-hmm.
It was them covering him. And then this whole one was basically the whole cartel war. But the way that they left the show off, it was right when Chapo was coming to power.
Yeah.
So the next season of Narcos is about to be like all of Chapo's fucking reign over everyone. And
oh,
I'm
shit.
Fucking hyped for that.
It's
shit,
just like caught up with his son or some shit like that. You heard that shit?
Yeah, bro. Bro, he's probably going to get out, though, bro. I don't know how the fuck El Chapo seems like he could get out.
This is crazy. Yeah. The cartel, that's serious business, man.
Oh God,
I think
bro.
They when they caught him, they tried to get him back, whatever. You know what I'm saying? So I'm like, it's wild down there, man.
Bro, I'll know this podcast has made it when I get to the level where I could interview, like, an El Chapo or some shit. Shit would be so fire if I could sit down with someone like that and just deconstruct how the fuck did you, like, get to where you are? Like, from the fucking beginning to where you are. But
you're going to have to break that to pieces. Like, Vlad, boy, that shit's gone.
That shit, bro.
That's going to be hard.
That shit would be mad hard, but that shit would be fucking fun, bro. What was the other one? Is it Paid in Full I'm thinking of?
Woo!
Paid in Full. Paid in Full is another fire ass one, bro.
It's my screensaver, man. You know what I'm saying?
Shout out Rich Porter, bro.
You know what I mean?
Shout out Rich Porter, bro. Yeah. They caught up with Alpo. You see that shit?
Yeah, they got with him.
They finally fucking caught up with him after the caliber.
I was just watching his, I think Rich Porter's sister did an interview with Vlad. I was watching that. You know what I'm saying? But to answer your question, that's another hobby I have too, just looking at interviews, documentaries.
Yeah.
Learning from history, man. Learning from this shit. You know what I'm saying?
What do you feel like has been the most like impactful on just you learning shit? Because I feel like I'm always preaching this to artists. If you watch podcasts and interviews of your favorite artists and just pick apart what they're saying, you could learn so much shit. Do you feel like that's been a dramatic impact, or the situations like you're saying of you being in the studio with people like PNB and shit? Like, what pointers would you say if you had to give three things that you would recommend to people just to start doing to learn shit? Like the interviews, being with artists that know more than them. What would you say? I know that question was kind of confusing.
I can break it down. You know what I mean? Just being around people that know more than you, learning off of them. You know what I'm saying? Trying to just, I'm a sponge, bro. You know what I mean? I try to just soak up as much information as I can, bro.
Yeah.
I watch a lot of Russ interviews, and I don't listen to too much Russ music, but I definitely like what he's preaching when he talks that business shit, dog.
He'd be smart as fuck, bro.
Yeah.
You read his book?
Nah, but I just got done watching. He did an interview with Steve Stout from the United Masters, and I just wanted to I'm in like the publishing space with my writing, so I mean, you know what I mean? So I'm like, oh, what more can I learn? Where else do I need to register songs to get more money?
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? So shout out to Russ, bro. So that's what I do, man, when I listen to podcasts. Like, what can I learn from? I don't watch too many. I mean, I do watch who I like, but whoever's like really successful in their space, I'll listen for sure.
Yeah.
Tank got a podcast. The R&B singer Tank got a podcast. He had a Money Long on there. You know Money Long?
Nah.
She's a female artist / songwriter. She just had a breakthrough song called Hours. I want to give you your flowers. Hours.
That shit sounds familiar.
Hours. But she's been writing for like 20 years. She wrote mad records, man. She just turned me up as far as like, hearing her story, like, she said, yo, Tank, I used to write, like, 3 songs a day. And I'm like, damn, 3 songs a day? I bet I got to write 4 now. You know what I'm saying? Like, that's the kind of guy I am. You know what I'm saying?
That shit's fire.
Hell yeah.
That shit's fire. Who would you say your three, I don't know if it's different influences, but if you had to give 3 influences, artists that were the most impactful to, like, you making your own music, and then 3 artists that you would say are the most impactful for just writing overall, if you had to give 3 examples of each of those.
On the writing side, I would say Neo, number one.
Damn.
Hell yeah, he wrote, what's that Beyonce song he wrote? You Must Not Know About Me, classic. Damn, writers, though. Yeah, Neo, Tank. He wrote a lot of R&B classics as well. And damn, in the writing space, there's a lot of writers back in the day, man. Damn. I'm drawing a blank. Shit. But I'll throw myself up there, man. Rosewood Bates. You know what I'm saying? Yeah, I'll throw myself up there, dog. But on the artistry though, for real, PNB Rock. When I first met Rock, it was tough because I was starstruck / like, I fuck with this dude. Like, how do I balance the two? Like, I'm really a fan of bro's music. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? And I was just...
That was right when he was coming up, too, right?
Yeah, man. I was just... His mannerisms, like, he just got it, man. He had it. Like, just the whole superstar thing, man. You know what I'm saying? And so, definitely Rock. Right now, I'd say, you know, Drake, obviously. Drake is someone who I like to try to get pieces from, you know what I'm saying, with his career. Like, all right, well, he didn't just do rap. He did R&B. Now he's doing, you know what I mean, you know... Was it the reggae John, and he's doing the UK, and he, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
So I definitely looked to Drake for that, just not being in the box, you know what I'm saying? And T-Lanez, man.
Damn.
Hell yeah, I know. Shout out to T-Lanez, though.
I wish they didn't just lock him up, man.
I wish too, man, but you know how it go, man. We'll see. We'll see what happens.
I don't know, bro. Let's see. They're locking everyone up right now. Andrew Tate's locked up, too.
You know what's crazy? Yo, who is that, though?
Like, you don't know Andrew Tate?
I see his... He's one of those guys, I see his face. I never locked in on, like, how he came up, what he does.
So,
like, you know what I mean?
He was, like... I don't quote me on this because I don't pay attention. I think kickboxing champion. Like, kickboxing world champion.
Yeah.
And then he made bread from that. And then he quit... Or it was before... He ran, like, a cam girl business and made, like, millions of dollars a year off that shit.
Cam girl.
Like, cam girls. Like, he had, like, a bunch of chicks living in a fucking house and would just make them do online cam chat shit and just made bread off that. All right. And then he just started preaching fucking, like, mad different shit, like, about how to treat women, fucking alpha male shit, and he's just gone viral on the fucking
internet. Like a Kevin Samuels, you know Kevin
Samuels? Yeah, but he's like, bro, his cult following is crazy. I don't know if it was some fake news account, because I don't be paying attention to Andrew Tate shit like that, but he has, like, fucking super fans. I don't know if it was real or fake, because how he's locked up right now in Romania, I saw that there was, like, some sort of, like, rebellion going on where there was people, like, literally protesting for this dude to get out of jail, so it was real, yeah.
I was scrolling, I saw that.
So that shit is real, but he got, like, a cult-ass following, like, I have friends that literally, like, look at this dude like fucking, like, God, bro. Like, they take, like, everything he says to heart. Yo, like, there's mad people, bro, that, like, take what this dude is saying serious. He be saying wreck-ass shit, though. He's like, oh, like, woman shouldn't be able to drive. He be saying crazy shit. But
guys like that, I don't know. Sometimes, you know, I don't know if they really do mean what they say, or they say shit for the clickbait or for the shock value. You know what I'm saying?
It'd be tough. Watch the Vice documentary they did on
Vice.
If you want to know, because basically Vice, I watched it. They spent, like, I think it was like 2 weeks, a month with the dude. And they kind of nitpicked it apart because he just got arrested on sex trafficking. Everyone's saying that's what it is. But they picked it apart, and there was a couple points in the documentary of him, like, breaking character. Like, literally, like, it was him filming his podcast, and then he, like, sidetracked the camera. They turned the camera off mid-thing, and then he literally told the dude, he's like, yo, like, you can roast me back, like, blah, 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 like, you're okay, I'm not, like, roasting you too much or whatever. And then the camera went right back on, and he went straight to being a dickhead. I was like, yo, this shit's a persona. But he's a genius, like, at marketing. Like,
yeah, he's marketing.
Bro, because he's banned off all social medias except for Twitter right now, because Elon brought his Twitter account. He's not allowed to have a TikTok. They canceled all... He had to make his own bank, bro, because they canceled his bank accounts. Uber banned him.
What?
Like, he got canceled, like, a Kanye level, except way worse. They won't let him have Instagram anything, but he's so viral, bro. His fans... He also has this thing called Hustlers University. That's like this whole business shit that fucking... They basically pay to learn how to be a fucking alpha male or whatever the fuck. But he literally has his fans, bro, they make accounts acting like him, and they just post his shit nonstop. They'll go clip his interviews and stuff. So he doesn't even have social media right now, and he's nonstop going viral. Like his,
that's crazy.
And he hasn't had social media for like 3 to 5 months or some crazy show like that, yeah, yo. And he's just nonstop viral everywhere. Yeah.
Damn, yo. And that's all just because of his opinions and what he preaches. All
motherfuckers literally be taking this shit like a Bible, bro.
That's crazy.
It shocks me. That's crazy.
You know? I look at cats like that and be like, damn, I got to find out how you market your shit.
Man. Oh,
like,
good.
That's it. Hey, that's, man, shout out to him.
Bro, I forget what the number is, but he was describing, he makes like some crazy shit, like $700,000 a month off that Hustlers University shit.
Yeah.
Like $700,000 a month or some crazy shit. And it's literally just him being like, you're the alpha male, fucking just talk to the girl this way. Like, it's literally just shit like that. I'm like, bro, what the fuck? Like,
golly. Okay.
That shit, yeah.
Andrew. Him. I hope he figures it out. You mean he's locked up right now?
Yeah, he's locked up on the fucking sex trafficking shit, supposedly, which I don't even fucking know, bro. The whole world is just so weird right now.
Everything's crazy right now, man. And that's why I'm hoping this Rose from Nothing will set shit back into place, man. You know what I'm saying? Rose from Nothing coming soon.
I'm hyped for
this
project.
I got Millie's on that, John. I got G Nipsey on there. You know what I'm saying? And, you know, couple of surprises on there that I can't speak on right now. But, you know what I mean? We tying fine. Up loose ends. You know what I'm saying?
That's just about to be fine.
Oh, yeah. We're looking at spring fine. Right now. But I got A-Zip on there, too. A-Zip. Yeah.
I got to get him on a pod, bro.
Shout out A-Zip.
I
got to
get him. And I got to get Millie's. Millie's, I'm getting you on a podcast this year.
Yeah. Nah. Shout out A-Zip, man. That whole Shooters music movement, they remind me of, like, Dipset, man. Like, you know, when they just... From the clothing line to just how they, you know what I mean, their stage presence, their show presence, the street
presence.
You
saw they were on the news yesterday?
Who?
They were on the news. Chilla was on the news.
Oh, yeah?
Chilla was on the news talking about Shooters, I'm pretty sure.
There we go. That's fire. Shout out Chilla. Yeah.
Chilla. Shout out all the Shooters, bro.
Oh, yeah.
Shout out all the Shooters. I love the collectives around here, man.
Me too.
Like, the collectives is mad. Like, shout out Chef Boys, shout out VB, shout out Shooters, like we just talked about. But there's just mad collectives, and I fucking love it. Were you ever part of a group at any point?
Or were you always solo? It wasn't like a group per se. It just, you know, when I had first bought my mic and shit, me and my man Q, we had me and my man Q and some other cat, we had a little group, man, but it didn't really work out the way we had envisioned it to work out. You know what I'm saying? We all had this one of them things where it's like we all got different sounds and we young, and you know what I'm saying, how do we mesh it? I mean, didn't really know how to mesh it per se. So I like to stand alone when it comes to, you know what I mean, this artistry shit. You feel me?
You got any managers or anything, or are you self-sufficient for the most part?
Pretty much right now, bro, self-sufficient, man. You know, don't get it twisted. I got people, you know, that'll financially help, you know what I'm saying? Yeah. Visuals and all that stuff, man, you know what I'm saying? My man Shiz, he helps me out a lot, you know what I'm saying, to get from one place to another, you know. But for the most part, I build relationships with people, cameraman, just different people who fuck with me, fuck with what I'm doing, and we figure it out from there.
How involved with the creative process are you when you go to do a video?
Oh, I'm hands-on.
Yeah, hands-on as
fuck? I'm a little too hands-on. I'm a little too hands-on. My man Tange had hit me for my last video. He was like, damn, bro, it don't even feel like I did the video. I was like, oh, my fault, man. You can put your input, man. You know what I'm saying? He's like, yeah, bro, come on, man. Trust me, man. You got to learn how to trust the creatives. I'm like, you're right, man. So,
bro.
Yeah.
I got to get Tange on here, too. Shout out Tange.
Go right there. Tange. It's funny. When I met Tange, he... I had heard of Tange, I think before he picked up a camera, he had did like a Miss Me, one of my records that was like really doing his thing out here called Miss Me. He had did a freestyle to it way before he ever picked up a camera.
He was rapping?
He was like rapping a little bit, you know what I'm saying?
I remember I heard the tales of when he had a studio in his basement or some shit.
Yeah, he was rapping. He rapped to one of my joints. I'm like, that was you? I remember getting tagged on Instagram. That was you? He's like, yeah. I'm like, oh, well, let's work then. It's crazy how the world works.
What the fuck, bro?
Hell yeah.
God damn. What's it like seeing... the evolution of this whole scene over here? Because if you've been in it that long, where you were seeing fucking when Tandra was rapping, like, how is it seeing your own growth, but also just seeing, like, all your peers grow along the way?
This is a beautiful thing, man. You know what I'm saying? It's a beautiful thing. I like to look at myself as one of, like, the forefathers out here, you know what I'm saying? Yeah. And just to see kind of what was left behind and, you know, to see what trickled after that, it's a blessing, bro. You know what I'm saying? I love it, and we need more. We need more for real, you know what I'm saying? And shout out to you for just, you know what I'm saying, just creating this platform for,
thank you,
dog, you know, creatives like myself to come out here and talk that shit, man.
Thank you, dog. Mm-hmm. Thank you. I love this scene right here. I know I've already said this multiple times throughout the podcast, but like where we're at right now, bro, it's just fucking amazing. Like,
yeah.
And it really is just amazing.
Hell yeah. I love it. I love it too, bro. So, you know what I mean? You know, I'm going to do my part, and then we're just going to turn up from there.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. How'd you get in the, I meant to ask you this way earlier, but how'd you get in the writing for other people? Like,
so the PNB Rock situation, the A&R, I had no intentions on doing that. It was the A&R had reached out to me to link with him. He was like, yo, you ever heard of PNB Rock? You ever heard of A Boogie? You ever heard of Kodak? Well, I'm the A&R of all three of those guys.
Goddamn.
And we need hooks. And you got hooks, you know what I'm saying? And one way for you to get into the game, you know, you could take the Tory Lanez Neo route of just kind of penning your artistry for people. And then now you're building repertoire. Now you're building relationships. You can get the features for damn near nothing, you know what I'm saying? And just, you know, it's a way to get in. And I was like, damn. I was like, bro, but you can't just sign me, though. Like, what's it? I was like, I ain't trying to write, you know what I'm saying? He was like, bro, like, you know what I mean? My budget, it's like, I already got these three. I'd hate to do that to you, man. But, yo, let's, you know what I mean? Let's come in, fuck with me. Just, you know what I mean? I'm like, all right, cool. So I spent a lot of time in Jersey and just, yo, just writing for cash. Just going through the whole motions, man. Just sitting on the couch, just watching artists do their thing. And I'm like, damn, but in Mass, they waiting for me to drop. Let me eat this for a little bit. Man, and do this. And man. Once I hit my first one, and yo, ended up working out, man. Just, you know what I'm saying? Just getting that publishing check just changed my life. Like, oh, okay. Yeah, how many more do you need? all right, cool. Now I could invest in this, and now I could invest in the videographer. Now I could do that. Okay, it's hand in hand.
That's just mad fire.
So that's how I got into the writing, man, and then just. And I treat the song like it's still mine. You know what I'm saying? Like, I treat it like it's still mine. Just playing back the records, like, yeah, nah, this is my song. You know, they singing it, but it's my song. You know what I mean? So it's cool.
Who else did you write for besides PNB?
Oh, man. I got disclosures for the other ones, man. But I can say one more is this cat named Bigger Dawn out of Jersey.
Damn.
Yeah, he's Trenton, New Jersey. He's on the come up right now. He got a song with No Cap. We just touched a million on a record called Pain.
That's fire.
Hell yeah.
That's fire.
Yeah, shout out to Bigger Dawn. Shout out, you know what I mean? Yeah, search Bigger Dawn Pain. It's out there.
What was the other one? Are both the plaques you have with PNB?
Yeah.
They both are?
Yeah.
That's fire.
It's his album plaque and then, you know, for the actual song and shit.
So the ones that you like can't talk about, are you not able to get plaques for those ones? Or are you still
I can
able
until
to,
after. Still, yeah, yeah. Well, like once after, it's out, it's you know, then yeah.
Damn. That's crazy.
We got to protect the artist too.
I'm so curious about that side of shit, bro, because people are always talking about it, but it's kind of like a mysterious like aspect of the music industry almost. Like there's not that much stuff out there about like the songwriters, but everyone that I know that does it, bro, I just hear about it, and I'm like, yo, this shit is low-key, if you're an artist, the perfect avenue for almost anybody to fucking take.
For sure. If you're one of those artists that just got mad shit that, you know... Me, I make songs, like, I make pop records, I make, you know what I'm saying, you know, retro sound. I do, like, you know, a lot of times I don't want to drop under my name, so I'll be on something like, man, like, I like this, but this doesn't really fit my brand right now. If I drop this, then they're going to expect me to move like this. Nah, let's give this to this person, you know what I'm saying, and, you know, let's see what that does, you know what I'm saying?
That's just fine.
Yeah, man, right now I'm trying to catch a big play, man. I'm trying to catch, you know what I mean, Beyonce, Bruno Mars, man. I'm trying to catch a big play, man, you know what I'm saying? That's my next goal right now.
That shit would be hard, bro.
Hell yeah.
That shit would be hard. How do you go about that, though? You were saying you treat it like your own song. Like, how different is it writing a song for somebody else versus writing it for yourself?
I'd say it's a little more easier, right? Only because when I write a song, I'm speaking from my life, my experience, my own personal traumas, my own personal, you know, grinds, you know what I mean? And so to hear someone else sing it, it kind of takes that pressure away a little bit, like, you know what I'm saying? They're making it theirs now. You know what I'm saying? They're putting their emotions in it. You know what I'm saying? So, yeah, it's my words, but it's their emotions, and it just comes out so beautiful. You know what I'm saying? So I like writing. I like writing for people. Damn. Yeah.
What would you give, like, for anyone that is interested in doing that? How would you recommend they go about it?
Yeah, leave your ego at the door, and then just leave your ego at the door, and just get out there and grind. Get in these studio sessions. Use Instagram as a tool to network and not just to, you know, to lurk. You know what I'm saying? Like get, you know, follow different A&Rs that, you know, I never look at the artist per se. I look at the people around them. Okay. Yeah. Like, okay, I can't get to this artist directly, but who's that person they're always posting? All right, I'm gonna follow them. Oh, this person only got 8,000 followers. Okay. They're touchable. Let me, you know what I'm saying? Let me see what this person's about. Let me email them. Let me send them hey, tap in with me. You feel me? So, yeah, that's literally the grind of what I've been doing this past 3.5 years, and it's worked.
Damn.
Yeah. We're going to catch some L's. A lot of L's, but we're going to focus on those.
You kind of answered because I was going to, my next question was going to be, what would just be your advice for any creative in general that's trying to get into whatever avenue they're taking, even if it's not music and they're trying to open up a brand or a clothing store, whatever.
Yeah.
Kind of answered that a little bit, but if you have any other additional advice, what would you recommend?
You know, as far as just using, you know, social media as a tool, yeah, just stepping outside, man, getting to these little, you know, mixers and networking events, you know, investing in yourself. That's something that I didn't do too much on early on. I wish I did. I was always cheap with my bread. You know what I'm saying? But I was like, nah, they, you know, but if you pay this, it'll, you know, it'll be played here. And I'm like, will really, really get played there? Like, you know what I'm saying? I was always just skeptical because the music business, you can get finessed. It can get shicey. These are the dark sides of the business that's not talked about too much, but it happens. And you just gotta really trust who's around you and the outlets that's really, you know, fucking with you, man. You know, so yeah, man, not being afraid to get out there and don't be afraid to walk up on someone who you really wanna, you know what I mean, tap in with. You know, I was watching it was a Kevin Hart interview on The Breakfast Club, and he had saw somebody, I think it was Jay-Z, it was someone who he saw he was in a room with. And he wanted to walk up on that person and hit the people around. Kevin Hart was like, nah, don't do that. He's going to look like, you know what I mean? And then Kevin Hart was like, well, what do you mean? I'm trying to pick this person's brain. I ain't, man, get out of here. I'm already Kevin Hart. What I got to lose? You know what I'm saying? And it worked out for him. So I took that little gem from that interview that I watched, and I'm like, yeah. Let me do that too. Let me not be afraid to just walk up on someone and pick their brain and just, you know what I mean? Learn.
That's just
fine. I don't want nothing from you. Maybe some knowledge, but I don't want your money. I don't want your, you know what I mean? Yeah.
Just be yourself and don't be fucking afraid.
Don't be
afraid.
Too, that
shit, that shit is fucking fire. We gotta do the last two questions though, because he gotta fucking go pick up a computer.
Let's get it.
But I want to ask. I think I asked you this kind of earlier. But if you think overall of your whole entire, from when you were 9 years old until where you're at right now, what do you think just has been the most impactful fuck up that you've made? That you just kind of like, I don't know, it was just very eye-opening to you and made you realize where you need to go with shit and learning from your mistakes type shit.
Just being more consistent. That's all.
Consistency.
Consistency. You know what I'm saying? And it sounds cliche, but it's true. It's real. You know what I mean? You got to be consistent in what you're doing. You know what I mean? And a lot of times I get lost in just, you know, the writer hat and then the artist hat. You know what I'm saying? Wearing both hats could be tough. But at the end of the day, you know, if you really love something, you really make the time for what you want to do.
Okay.
So, yeah, I'd say that, man, just the consistency part of it. You know what I mean? And, you know, and this year we're gonna see. You know what I mean? You know, so hold me accountable. I got you.
That consistency, bro, is key. Yeah. Everyone's always preaching that, and you don't realize it until you are consistent for a period and you slow down, and then you have to see the fucking decline in analytics,
man. I've been through it all, man. I've been through it all. I'm like, you know what I mean? Because I get the emails. I get the Apple Music, the Spotify monthly listeners, you know what I'm saying? I'm like, yo, how I go from 50K a month to this? How I go from, I'm like, oh, shit, I got to, you know what I mean? But yeah, man, you know, it was a Will Smith interview I saw on Breakfast Club where he's like, yo, when one thing goes really right, meaning like for me, when the writing goes really well, just kind of fades down a little bit, the artistry. When the artistry goes really well, you know what I'm saying, the writing networks kind of slow down a bit, you know what I mean? It's how do we find the medium? And I'm still trying to figure it out, but I'm going to figure it out, and, you know, it's what I love to do. Yeah.
Final question for the super fans. This one's for the super fans and people that really, really fuck with you.
Yeah.
What's a day in the life of Rosewood Babe like?
Day in the life of Rosewood Babe. Wake up in the morning, put on a beat, freestyle for a little bit, feed my kids, and tap in, look into my phone, see what's going on outside. You know what I mean? That's just kind of my way of kind of, you know, being in touch with the world, social media, and then see what's going on. Tap in with a lot of the engineers that I know. Send them records that are just sitting in my email. Like, I think I want to drop this. I think I want to, you feel me? I'll do that. Hit the gym a little bit. Shit, man. And then, yeah, see what the flight tickets is looking like for the prices. See what the flight tickets is looking like and seeing where I can go. And I might pop in, you know, an interview that I really like to just get some gems off of it. Listen to an audio book. Tap in with my loved ones, the family, you know what I'm saying, my Dukes and them. And, yeah, tap in with the people out of state. make plans to see them. Try to just, you know, stay consistent with myself. Like, all right, well, I'm in Mass for too long. It's time for me to go to this place. You know what I mean? And yeah, bro, just keep doing that all over again until a blessing appears, man, or a door opens and the opportunity comes to take advantage of. Hell yeah.
Fire. Fire. Hustler.
Gotta hustle, man. You gotta hustle, man. You gotta take sacrifice, take risks, and you know what I mean? It'll pay off in the end, man. Calculated risk.
Yeah. Oh, God. People do not realize the sacrifice that goes into doing this shit.
Oh, yeah.
Sacrifice one of the key components, man.
Facts. Even when I'm here right now, that's my phone was buzzing like 10 times. Yeah. Man. Like, that's family hitting me up right now. Like, you know what I mean? The money's calling, shit. You know, you got to make time for what you really love, man.
Oh, God, bro.
Yeah. Oh, God. So I had to come check
you,
man. Shout out to Do If It Don't, man. You know what I mean? Rosewood shit. Be somebody. Somebody. You know what I'm saying?
Yo, thank you for coming on, though, dog. This was a great-ass episode, bro. I've fallen in love with this shit so much recently because I've just been having guests that I, like, fucking just love hearing their stories, but this was a great one, man.
Yeah, man. You know, this is the real me, man. This is Rosewood Bait, man. You feel me? And I'm happy I got to tell that story here for real, man.
So. I see why so many people were recommending you after doing this interview.
Yeah.
I see why so many people were, bro.
Appreciate you, bro. I appreciate you, man, reaching out. And I appreciate what you're doing, man. And I'm rooting, man. You know what I mean?
You,
I need some of that merch, man. You know what I'm saying? I seen some merch out here, man.
We're about to sell out right now.
Yeah. We need that Playboy on the wall, too. I seen Matt Albums on the wall.
We're going to get some albums. We need that new one on the wall. That's
I got you. I got you.
That new one. Send me the cover art once you get the cover art.
Let's get it.
Get that shit, bro. Thank you for fucking coming on, though. Tag your Instagram so they can follow you.
Of course, man. Rosewood Bape on all social media platforms, man. You know what I'm saying? Rosewood Bape everywhere. You know what I'm saying? Tap in, man. Tap in. Yeah.
Appreciate you once again, dog. Appreciate you. Hopefully, we see Rosewood in some more content. We're going to start some new content this year. We're going to get back into the vlogs and a whole bunch of other shit.
Yes, sir. If
you guys want to see us do more shit, comment that shit below. And also, I need to stop saying this shit because if you don't get it through your heads, I don't know what the fuck is wrong with you. But if you watch this whole hour and 15-minute long podcast and you did not click subscribe or you did not click like button, do that shit right now.
Tap in, subscribe, tap in to the Rosewood channel too.
Yeah, tap in the Rosewoods. He will literally be linked on the title of this video, so you have no reason to also click the subscribe button. And also go on Instagram and click that blue button that says follow and make that shit gray for him.
Yeah.
Same thing with our Instagram if you somehow aren't following us on Instagram, man. But shout out Rosewood Bape. Shout out DOD. Thank you guys for watching, and we'll see you on next week's episode, who I do not know who it will be yet. Actually, it will be Retro. He's outside right now. So, shout out Retro. But let's get it.
All I want to know is the no money. All I want to know is would you do it for me? All I want to know is would you ride for me? If it ever came, would you slide?